Welcome to the third episode of the Spike Lee Inside Man podcast. Today we visit another location in Manhattan as we send our shadow caster Human Newman on a quest to find the bank building near Wall Street to collect another impression of the filmmaking process from Spike Lee himself. We pick up our story as Human is on his way and once again, hopelessly lost.
All right, I see the sky. Coming up the steps. I'm at the site of the World Trade Center. The pit is directly to my left. I'm trying to get my bearings now to head in the right direction. I'm headed toward Dey Street, D-E-Y Street. I walk in the direction that my instinct tells me to go in. Some of you that have heard the other podcasts are laughing now. Man, none of these streets, I'm only a few blocks from, okay, I see the flag of Wall Street Stock Exchange across the front of the Stock Exchange. And I can see that I'm in sight of the Stock Exchange straight ahead of me. Liberty Avenue, straight ahead. All right, I'm on the wrong side. This map is worthless. God damn it. Could have done this on my own. Shouldn't have looked at the map. Google, you piece of shit. Okay, now I see some production equipment. I see William Street. Walking towards some gear. The security man there should have stopped me, but he didn't. He's talking to some girls. I'm at 20 Exchange. Fuck. Well, don't tell me you're wrapping up. Hell no. They're not actually shooting inside, I don't think. Yeah, the doors are closed. I'm going in. Hey there. Where's the shoot going on, sir? I gotta find some people that are part of this shoot.
Shoot?
The Spike Lee movie.
That's right. Hello. You're talking about the back.
Come around the back. Got through here? Thank you. Thank you very much. They're set up for night shooting here. Yeah. They've got a giant a light balloon. I don't know what they. What do you call this thing here? What's the technical term for that?
A balloon.
A light balloon?
Yes, a light balloon.
Yeah, there you go, I guess correctly. It's tethered, and what's keeping it up there?
Helium.
Oh, okay.
It's a balloon full of helium.
And then it's lit up to give even lighting?
Yeah, there's 8,000 watts in there.
Ah.
8,000 watts of daylight balanced light in there.
Really bright?
Yeah, and it's 10 foot by 10 foot, that particular one.
We are standing at Hanover and Beaver, I believe is the intersection we're at right now. Mulholland is over that way. It took me a while to find this spot because of all the zigzagging streets in New York. It's people that are listening to this podcast are going to say, man, what was so hard about it?
Are people planning on coming down here to see a movie being made?
No, this will be aired in a few weeks.
Excellent, because there's nothing in the world more boring than watching a movie get made. It's like watching paint dry. With actors.
I'm following this guy. See you later. Nice talking to you. I'm being directed by... Hey, there's Juan. I recognize Juan. How are you? Good to see you. All right, Juan.
Were you pre-roll?
I was. Yeah, we're rolling B. I got lost getting here, man. It took me forever.
Yeah, we gotta work it out.
This is a beautiful building. I'm inside of what is a bank, right? Hi. Hello. How are you, Mr. Lee? It's good to see you again. Please, every time I catch you, I'm interrupting your dinner. I'll wait, if you'd like.
No, I'm right.
This is beautiful.
See you later.
enter a banker's office where Spike Lee is seating me next to him behind the desk. Mr. Lee, how are you?
Good.
Welcome back to Spike Lee's podcast.
Well, here we are. Tuesday, July 12th, in the year of our Lord, 2005. And this is day 11 of the shoot for Inside Man, starring Denzel Washington, Clive Owen, Jodie Foster, William Dafoe, Christopher Plummer, Chiwetel Ejiofor, and I'm very happy to say that everything looks great. We've been looking at dailies. Scenes been cut together nicely, but as any experienced filmmaker would tell you, you know, being that saying all that, you never know what you really have till everything's cut together at the end. But so far, it's going good. The last week we've been here at this location of the bank here in New York City, in the heart of Wall Street. The people who, the businesses and the people who work here in Wall Street have been cooperating with us very much. And chugging along. When you shoot a film, it's more like a marathon than a sprint. And for me, I don't say I got X amount of days left. Just one day at a time. Every day come to the set, you have a certain amount of scenes you have to shoot, a certain amount of pages you want to shoot. So at the end of the day, when you call wrap, hopefully you got everything that was on the call sheet when you began that morning.
You were mentioning that you were watching dailies. Can you go into a little more detail on that? What's involved in watching dailies?
Dailies is when the filmmakers look at the work that's been previously shot. And so when we're shooting days, after we finish shooting for 12, 13 hours, then we watch dailies. When we're shooting nights, we watch dailies before we go to the set. For me, I always have my editor, Barry Brown, long trusted editor, Barry Brown, sitting to my right, to my left. And to my right is my director of photography on this film, this wonderful, great young cinematographer. His name is Matty LaBatique. Matty and I shot many commercials together. He shot my previous film, She Hate Me. He also shot for Darren Aronofsky, Pie, Wrecking for a Dream, and Darren's new film called The Fountain, starring Hugh Jackman. So again, my editor is to my left and my cinematographer is to my right. And my editor is taking notes and I'm giving him, saying, I like that, I like this, I don't like that. And he's taking these notes down, so we'll have them when he edits all these shots together. He's cutting. We have a very short post-production period to edit, so sometimes filmmakers wait till they've done, then they start editing. But I can't do that. So Barry Brown is editing while we are shooting. And even today when we broke for dinner, he came by the DVD, some scenes he's cut. So I'll go watch that tonight when I go home.
Well,
today was today was Clive Owen's first day. So we're very everybody's glad to have get him into the mix.
Were you watching those on small screen or large screen?
No, we watch our dailies at Technicolor. So we watch them high definition projection.
And so your day's not going to be over for a long time.
Well, call today was at 11. We're breaking for dinner. Now we broke for dinner at 7:30. We come back like 9:15. We got a light. We have a shot. We have to shoot one more scene tonight between, a very important scene between Denzel Washington and William Dafoe. So that's going to take, I'll probably be home by midnight tonight. But tomorrow, our call is at 3. So we'll watch dailies for 90 minutes. Watch dailies from 1 to 2:30. Take a half an hour to get this set. We have a couple scenes in a day. Then break for dinner. We got a lot of night stuff to shoot tomorrow night. And then Thursday is all nights.
How do you break the tension?
Oh, try to get a massage at the end of the week. What I try to do is, I a lot of times I yell and scream. I get a heart attack if I didn't do that. Because I know I might have said this before, but shooting the film was like trying to... This is not something I made up. It's not original, but it is nonetheless still, it's a truism. Making a film is like trying to push an elephant up, a mountain. And you gotta push people, and I gotta tell them, look, we need this, we need this, we need this. And it was not happening fast enough, and that's when I gotta start yelling and screaming.
Everyone knows, though, that you probably... you're not really angry, you're just...
I'm angry.
You're angry.
When I ask somebody to do something, and 20 minutes later, or even less than that, it's not done, then I'm angry. Because time is money. I'm ready to shoot. And number one, I don't like to keep actors waiting. There's so much to do with study. The more actors have to wait, I think it really affects negatively their performance.
There's a magic hour.
Say that again?
There is a magic hour, sort of like putting the horses in the Kentucky Derby gate.
I don't think that's the term, but the people I work with, ready to work, they're ready to act, and they don't want to spend the bulk of their day sitting in a trailer, sitting in a Winnebago, waiting for when they should be called to the set.
I was looking at the light as I was coming down here, and it was real golden and pretty. Was that planned in any of your shots here? Have you gotten any of that light?
No. When the sunset, we just finished the sequence inside the bank, and now we broke for dinner, and so waiting for it to get dark now.
And you're going to shoot night shots here. Is that any different than shooting day?
I hate shooting nights. Every human being has an internal clock. And I'm not really a nocturnal person. My wife is, Tanya. We're completely opposite in that regard. I wake up early. I do my best work in the morning. She stays up late at night and I'm in the bed, so... For me, nights are hard, especially when you have a string of nights together, because when it's light outside, my body just tells me I should not be sleeping. And so it's hard for me to sleep, but when you work nights, you come in at 6 p.m. and then you go to sunrise. So you probably get home 6:37, even though your body knows it's tired. It's still hard for me, to fall asleep. So I'm not a fan of shooting at nights.
As far as the movie's going, have you made any changes? Any idea changes? Or is Everything sticking according to plan?
Everything is going to plan. You know, we've been making adjustments on the script, but that happens all the time. So, I mean, a script is a blueprint. It's not written in stone. And I encourage the impact. I encourage the actors, you know, their input. I encourage the input of the actors, and so therefore you will have changes. And the people I work with, again, their instincts are so good, I would say 85% of the time when they suggest something, it's for the betterment of the film.
Do you have any idea this early on whether this is a masterpiece of yours or not?
First of all, I don't think like that. And that's not, I'm not being disrespectful to you.
Excuse me for posing it that way.
No. No excuses needed. I think that when you go into doing something, saying I'm going out to make a masterpiece, that's really setting yourself for failure. You just want to try to do the best job you can, and if the gods deem it, it will happen. I mean, people say that Malcolm X and Do the Right Thing are two of my best films, and you know, I didn't try any harder on those films than the other ones. You know, as I said before, I will continue to say there's so many intangibles that must, you know, there's so many alignment of the stars that the come. So many things have to happen for that type of film to exist. So, a lot, you know, it's hard work. A lot to do with the script. Time and luck.
Tell me about some of these locations that you've been shooting. You had any favorites yet?
Well, I love this bank location. We're able to find a bank right here on the corner of Exchange and Hanover Street, right in the heart of Wall Street. This bank was built in the 1920s. And then when we found it, it was unoccupied. It's exactly what we needed. We're building a stage. On the stage, there's some new stages here in Brooklyn called the Brooklyn Navy Yard Stages, and the lower floors of the bank in this location we built on that stage. Wynn Thomas is my production designer, longtime collaborator. Wynn did my first film, we started out together. So, I mean, 20 years ago, we did She's Gonna Have It. And here we are 20 years later, he's the production designer, as he was on that film. So, Wynn is doing a great job. You know, we're just very happy with the way things are going.
Are you doing something exterior today? Because I see a light, balloon light out there on the street.
Oh, yeah, we have a night shot tonight. So the shot tonight, when we come back from dinner, will be a night sequence involving Denzel Washington and William Dafoe.
You're keeping the storyline pretty close to your breast there. Any reason why?
Well, I really think that I want our listeners. It's not, I don't think it's really important for them to know what the film's about. It's really, for me, it's more about, you know, what I do as a director, what is happening on this film, not necessarily what this film is about.
I wish I could shadow you for a while and watch you command the ship, as they say.
Well, I don't know if that's going to happen. Not
okay. Well, I don't know.
How many of these have...
There are two in the can. First one's going to air. There's something to do with a picture of yours that has to be worked out. Something Apple wants when the podcast is on, photographs can flash up on the player, and they want your picture, and I don't know what's going on with that.
Picture of me? They can't get one?
I don't know what's going on. Well, we'll have to have Juan work that out. Yes.
Paul, I want to write this down so you get your picture. I don't want this to be delayed.
I think it was going to air this week. I didn't hear the full details because I'm just a production guy here. I don't really... know those details. I saw an email go back and forth to Juan. And Spike writes down a piece of paper here. Thank you. I think some more questions. Can you kind of walk me through a typical production scene? Can you, like, what is it that you do as a director? I mean, the director's there, and I think I asked you this question before, but what I was really looking for was actually hearing it in your mind. Okay, where's the camera? The camera's in position.
Well, I read, first of all, I know the scene, I've read it. And also before, we've done a lot of work during pre-production, but before I go to bed, I read what I'm going to shoot, what's coming up the next day. While I'm in the car riding to the set, I'm reading also what we're going to shoot. And so, I've already thought about how we're going to shoot it. And so when I get to the set, I meet with the director of photography, Matty LaPatique. I meet with the gaffer, Lamont Crawford. I meet with the key grip, Lamont Crawford. I meet with
What are you meeting with them for?
Excuse me.
What? Why are you meeting with them?
Because they have to know. Everybody needs to know what's going to happen, and they get that information from the director. So instead of saying it 10 million times to get everybody together at the beginning of the day and say, look, here's the plan, what we're going to do, so everybody knows what we have to do, and they could be a step ahead of me, a step ahead of us, knowing that I have to explain everything else. They know this is what we're doing today. And then Maddie and I sit down, and we discuss where we're going to place the camera. What lenses? Is there going to be movement? All that type of stuff.
And then he places the camera in place. And what's your next move?
Well, if the actors are still in makeup, we use the stand-ins to just walk through the stuff. Once the actors come from the set, dressed, they're wired, radio, microphones put on them, and then we rehearse. We try to work out the acting at the same time, working out the movement of the camera and getting the focus marks and stuff like that. And we also, if we have background on that, we have to work on that. That's like we have cars or people in the background. They have to get propped out. And then we keep shooting till we get it right.
And I've seen directors on sets before. They watch a screen. Yes.
Right.
What are you looking for in that monitor?
I'm looking for a lot of things in the monitor, but most importantly, performance goes above everything else. I know we're back in. I know performance goes before everything else, and you have to make adjustments to the actors. I go out, get up from behind the monitor, go tell the actors to what I need, and speak to the camera people, the operators, and tell them to make adjustments, and we just keep going till we get it right.
Can you call it for me the way you do the speed?
How does that go?
I said, are we ready? Roll sound. And I say, action. And I say, cut. Let's go again.
Mr. Lee, thank you so much. I hope to see you one more time. Yes? It'll be fun. And one of these days, you're going to have to let me piggyback on you and watch you do your thing. Spike Lee leaves the room dressed in a pair of shorts, a casual shirt, and his diamond earring in place in his left ear. Some tennis shoes. Always looking sharp. Wearing a baseball cap. No glasses today. His trademark glasses were not on. He leaves me at the desk here in an old bank with walls made of solid wood. Beautiful wood. The cost of this would just be off the scale if he wanted to build something like this. Spike Lee Podcast.
Next week, we'll bring you the final episode of this four-part series of podcasts from Spike Lee. Will Shadowcaster Human Newman be able to find the designated location in time to wrap it all up? Will he acquire the desired headshot of Spike? We'll find out next week on the Podshow production of the Spike Lee Inside Man podcast.